All right, another podcast from the Michigan Institute of Athletics in Brighton, Michigan. I'm super stoked about this podcast today.
Oh boy.
I'm joined by an absolute killer on the mats, savage wrestling coach, travels all over the country, next level wrestling. And for those of you that don't know him, the gentleman's name is Mike Krause. For the people that don't know you at home that are going to be watching, let's talk a little bit about your background. You know, how'd you get in the sport of wrestling?
All right, James.
Anything you want to tell.
Thanks for having me, and thanks for putting me through that hour workout at jiu-jitsu with the purple belts. I'm still sweating.
No problem.
I think my arm's a little numb from getting bent in that Kimura 10 times. But anyway, I'm here. Okay, I started wrestling late in the game, ninth grade. I played football. I was 112 pounds. And all my buddies were like, Krause, you got to wrestle. I thought wrestling's really a sport. I mean, we had it in eighth grade where you take your shirts off and you're in your jeans and you just go at it. And I remember wrestling this guy named Kevin Walken. I beat him, but I wasn't really captivated by it. So anyway, 2 weeks late in the season, I was going to a National Honor Society meeting because I had a 4.2 grade point average.
Oh, yeah.
I'm no dummy. But after the meeting, I walked up to the wrestling room and I was sitting there staring, watching these guys. And I remember they're all in a line doing fan drags to body locks. And I was sitting there watching it, and my coach now is Mike Abdo. He comes up to me and he goes, what are you doing? I go, oh, I'm just watching. He goes, well, get in here. I go, I'm playing baseball. He goes, baseball's next season. And I thought, right there is a defining moment in my life. Because I could have been like, hey, man, I'm out of here. I don't want to do this. But I thought, man, this guy's calling me out. Okay. So I went down and got my gym clothes on. And I kept my sneakers on. And I commenced to get my butt totally kicked. I mean, kicked to the point where I was disheveled, the fact that I didn't know what was going on. These guys who I thought I could kick their butts in the hallway were beating the tar out of me. No one slowed it down. No one told me what we were doing. And we were going live, and I was just getting waxed. And I remember being in the locker room, and I was toweling off. And everyone was like, Krause, you wrestling? And I was like, I don't know. Maybe. I don't think so. Because I couldn't commit, because I didn't know what just happened. So I went home that night, and I remember I was just stewing. I was thinking, oh my gosh, how'd those guys crush me like that? And I said, Mom, I need a pair of wrestling shoes. She goes, oh, why is that, Michael? I said, because I'm going to be a wrestler. So I jumped right in.
What a wild beginning story. What would your life look like had you not walked in that room on the mat? That's unbelievable.
I don't know. I wouldn't have the confidence I have today. I wouldn't have the confidence. I wouldn't have the work ethic. I wouldn't have the drive. I wouldn't have the, basically the confidence. Wrestling gives you, combat fighting gives you confidence. So I just, I joined the team, and after 2 weeks, I kind of started figuring it out. And during challenge matches, I won my challenge match. I was a 105-pound varsity kid. I went 15-15-1 my first year, and God bless my coach, Mike Abdo. No one told me to keep wrestling in the summer, so I just twiddled my thumbs and waited until the next season, which, you know, hindsight, oh my gosh, come on, really? And I kept plugging away. Went to the J-Rob. I did a camp. Went to a bunch of wrestling camps. And I was the first all-state wrestler in the history of Livonia Churchill. Thank you very much.
Wow.
Yeah.
So from the guy that was just watching from the outside that got called out, and your ego said, you know what, I'll step up to the plate. Then the course of your life drastically changes.
100%.
And then you end up being the first person to ever go all-state from your school.
I lost in the semis in overtime. I could have won it, but I took fourth. And I'm very proud of that, actually, because there was no tradition. And I thought, you know what, someone's got to try to win this thing, you know? So I gave it my all.
So now, did you go on to wrestle in college, or then how did you get to coaching?
Okay, so I was I was a pretty smart kid. I had some small scholarships. I had a scholarship to Ferris, and Olivet, of course, recruits everybody. But I was going to go to Michigan State because flat out my parents went to Michigan State, so I was going there no matter what. So I got a recruiting trip to Michigan State, but they offered me no money, but I didn't care. I wasn't looking for a scholarship. I just wanted to keep wrestling. So I walked on basically, and after about the about the third or fourth month, someone got hurt in the lineup, and I snuck in there at 167 against Iowa. I traveled to Iowa for my first varsity match in front of 10,000 fans.
Wow.
And I got smoked, but the bottom line is it was super fun, and they offered me a scholarship after that. I got a tuition scholarship, and from then on I was in the lineup every year, and I was definitely over my head, jumping into not being a blue chipper out of high school, but that might be the title of my book, Over My Head. Always over my head. I'm always in over my head. I don't give a rip.
Dude, I'm the same way. I back myself into a corner. I make myself find a way to be successful.
Exactly.
I set the goal so unbelievably high that it's like everyone tells me, you're not going to be able to do that. You're not going to be able to reach that.
Right.
And then we do it,
If they're not laughing at your goals, they're not big enough.
100%. So then how did you end up getting back into the sport of wrestling as a coach?
Well, here's the deal. When I was on the team, I was a walk-on, and then I earned a scholarship. And ever since my sophomore year, there's always say 10 or so walk-ons. And I really felt for these guys, because you don't get shoes, you don't get the gear, you're not one of the cool dudes, and I really took those guys under my wing, and I really, and my buddy James Richardson used to always call him the All Krause team. Like, anyone who was a walk-on was the All Krause. I took pride in that, because I had to coach these guys during the season. I was like, hey man, you guys can't quit. I know the world's stacked against you. We're going on these open tournaments. You're missing classes, but you can't quit, man. Just stick with it. And so right then I became a coach, to tell you the truth, actually. And when I got done with wrestling in college, I came back home, and I really have the it's my calling to inspire others. It really is. So I went to my alma mater, Livonia Churchill, and I'll say it like it is. They were kind of having a loosey-goosey practice, and it really didn't sit well with me. So I heard that Livonia Stevenson had a couple tough kids, and so I went over there, and they welcomed me with open arms. My buddy Bob Morosa had come on in, and after a while, I became the technique coach. You know, we had older guys that were doing the other ins and outs of coaching, but these guys on Livonia Stevenson are. And it blows my mind that they're all like 45 years old right now, because I was only 24 years old when I first started coaching these guys. But we took a team, Livonia Stevenson, that had, again, one All-State kid in the history of their program. And when I got done in 9 years, we had 35 All-State kids, 2 All-State teams, and 3 conference titles, and 5 state champs.
Man.
And that's coaching kids from scratch, from high school. We had no feeder program.
So in my opinion, at being a coach too, it's because of the passion. You're really dedicated.
Yeah.
You're not there to get a paycheck. No, just to like...
I didn't get paid. I wasn't even getting paid.
It's passion. Right. So passion is fueling your mission at this point. You're killing it wherever you go. Yeah. And then, so I knew you from Heartland.
Right.
How did you end up at Heartland? And then let's fast forward
so
now.
So I got married, and my first son, Jake, he's labeled autistic, but he's special needs. He's 20 years old right now, but he's kind of like a second grader mentally. Greatest kid ever, But anyway, we moved from Redford to Heartland because Heartland had a great special needs program. So when I got there, I quit. I went from Stevenson to Heartland. Oh wait, Stevenson to Novi, because I coached Ryan Terrell. I was Ryan Terrell's workout partner. And then we moved to Heartland. And then I went in the room and said, the coach there wasn't very receptive to anyone helping. So I just put the headgear on and rolled with the kids. And then I was like 30. I was 31. And I was just train wrecking everybody, and I did some of my best coaching on the team, just beating kids up,
Yeah, just giving them that real work.
Yeah, right. Figure this out, kid.
There's only so many times your head's going to bounce off the mat before you figure it out.
Yeah, right, exactly. So that's I got to Heartland. That's where I met you. And I didn't know, and I first met you back at the CC when you're doing that talk to the football team. You brought it up, and I didn't know it was you, but I remember exactly who you are, because you came in the room with all your buddies, and I was finishing up with the youth practice, and you're like, hey, man, you mind if you roll? I was like, yeah, go ahead. What are you guys doing? And you guys were doing jiu-jitsu before jiu-jitsu was even known.
Oh, yeah.
You're bending arms and twisting things. I was like, what the heck are you guys doing? And I remember saying to you, well, if someone breaks their arm, don't tell anybody. Just take it out of here.
I remember that exact conversation.
And you were like, all right, man, cool.
You were awesome with us. Yeah. I mean, because that's back in like 03, 04. Yeah. Nobody knew what jiu-jitsu was.
I didn't know what you guys were doing.
And we're strangling each other up there and doing all kind of things that a school would not allow.
I was sitting and watched for a little bit, and I was like, what the heck? That's cool.
So in a certain way, you're a part of the Michigan Institute of Athletics creation story.
Without me, we wouldn't be here.
Because think about this. You don't let me teach in that room. Right. All of a sudden, I don't create a following. Who knows what happens?
Yeah, you get hooked on. I'm just kidding.
But here we are sitting at a podcast in, the future of what that essence was.
Right.
Just like me and you, I looked at these. I had a passion for wanting to help other people. I liked making people feel cool, teaching them an awesome sport, and it fills you up. What I mean?
Right. On my poster, I've got the definition of being cool is making other people feel cool.
Spot on.
Totally.
100%. And so much happiness comes back in your life when you promote that type of happiness in other people.
I mean, think about that. I mean, we're being kind of quirky about this, but I don't want to say I helped you, but that might have not happened. You're right. I mean, little things like that
100%.
During your life. Yeah, God, that's
I was sneaking up into the Heartland wrestling room because I didn't know where to practice because my parents kicked us out of my house. So my parents would leave. Yeah. We would move all the furniture, and we were beating the shit out of each other right in the living room. So then my parents were like, you got to get this out of here.
Yeah, or learn how to do drywall repair.
Yeah, I had nowhere to go.
Right.
So I was like, we're going to sneak into the wrestling room and just do jiu-jitsu. Like, we're all there because we want to be. We're not going to hurt each other. You know what I mean? And like, you were the person that almost allowed that to take place.
Wasn't Funk there too, Chris? Was it Funk?
Much later. Craig was getting teased in high school. So I stepped up and helped that kid out. I actually confronted his bully at Heartland High School.
Nice.
Craig was basically getting picked on real bad. I heard about it. I'm like, man, what's wrong? This kid's huge. Like, do something about it. And he grew up to be, right? So I'm like, well, point out the kid that's picking on you. I'm going to go up to him. And I jumped in the kid's face and told him I'd beat him his ass. Whatever.
Right.
Anyway, fast forward. I started teaching Craig martial arts because I'm like, you need to turn this thing around. You need to get, you know, get your mind going right and start defending yourself, man. Nice. And then, you know, fast forward to now, look at what Craig's done with himself.
That's perfect. Yeah, Funk Fitness. Hey, I'll tell you what we should do in the future. We should do anti-bullying talks. I did one in Pennsylvania.
100%.
And it was so fun. And the kids were elementary. I think past elementary, it's kind of like they're already gone. But you can catch them at elementary and totally brainwash them into saying being cool is making other kids feel cool. Turn around, shake your buddy's hand, tell him he's cool. You're cool. You know. Anyway, I think that's a
wrestling huge. Coach, professional right. fighter, coach. Right. We go around together. Mm-hmm. We hit the schools. We're both high energy. The kids would eat it up.
Oh my gosh.
Show them a little bit of technique at the end. You throw me. Right. I show a submission. The kids are on fire.
I'm Coach Krause character. I got the big Adidas warm up on with the metal whistle.
Yeah, they'd love
it. Total character.
They would love it.
I'm telling you, man. It has to happen.
So then from Heartland, you ended up leaving Heartland. You got to Catholic Central at some point.
Yeah, okay, Mitch came and saw me at Bob Moreau, the guy who was at Stevenson, coached at CC, and told Mitch, because Mitch is like 2008, 2009, saying, oh, you got to get Krause, man. Krause is, you know, he coaches kids. Mitch came in the room, and I was like, oh, Mitch Hancock, because I remember when Mitch was in high school. He's like, hey, and then he helped out with the practice, and then he called me and said, you want to come to CC? I said, no, you know, Mitch, I appreciate that, but I live in Heartland. I really want to coach where I live. And then things went a little rocky at Heartland. So I was like, you know what? Ding dong, I'm coming. And from there, the 10, 11 years at CC, we just absolutely dominated.
That's what I want to go into, at least for a minute, before we go into more about your story. Why does DCC just absolutely crush the opposition always?
Well, I'll tell you what, seriously, I walked the halls for 10 years, and if you walk the halls, Every kid's wearing a little polo striped shirt. You can't really find, there's no like monsters. There's no like super, and there's a few here and there, but they're like normal. They're like normal kids. You're like, man, where's the holy, the 6 foot 8 kid?
What's the secret sauce?
I'll tell you, even the football team, the football talk, like there's a couple of big kids, like, Stevie Kolchev is huge, but they're not that big. Here's what it is. It's a mentality, man. It is the mental strength that school gives those kids. You know what? It really is. It's a family, it's a brotherhood, and we are CC. And I tell you what, man, you go there, you just feel like you deserve to win. The traditions, it is unbelievable. You walk the halls with all those pictures, it's like, oh my gosh, you think you deserve it. I mean,
the energy
it's
there is just infectious.
The whole program from the AD.
The structure from the ground up just makes you think I'm a winner.
Aaron Babbitts to the AD, he lives there, he's fantastic. Every coach is a diehard coach. It really is. It's phenomenal.
Yeah, they're next level.
Coach. Yeah, it really is.
And everybody knows it. Yeah. Everyone knows that Catholic Central. The second those words come up, you think of winners.
It was really fun being at CC. We'd walk into the room, being the defending state champs in the wrestling room, like a tournament, and the whole place like, dun, dun. I'm like, what's up? We're here.
it's just a vibe. It's an energy. They just know.
It really is, man. I mean, and it might be the gear, because I always joke around at all the banquets we have, obviously. And I came here initially for the gear, because we have the coolest gear, because we do,
Yeah, it is. Yeah. I mean, a lot of the guys wrestle here on Friday nights. We have open wrestling here every Friday night, and the DCC guys just have been flooding the room, mm-hmm. and they just look the part.
I know.
The second they step out on that mat, you're like, okay.
Oh my God, it's true. My son Andrew wrestled there his freshman and sophomore year, so I coached the JV with Mike Carrier, and it was super fun. And Shane Butwell, but even our JV and freshman team, the 34 stringers, we go to a JV tournament and we all looked the part, and we all had a good warm up, and we all drilled like rock stars. Other teams are hanging on their pajamas, not looking the part, not knowing how to warm up, and they'll just watch us. And I'm like, I used to say to Mike Carrier, everyone's just staring at us because they're like, wow. And I'm like, this is what we do. We know what we're doing.
You're mentally breaking your competition before it even starts. They're looking at those people going, I wish we were cool like that.
Yeah, and I'll say one last thing. I did if you see the state champ pictures, we have like 8 coaches. And I was at an NCAA wrestling party one time. This guy, I don't remember who he was, but he goes, oh, I saw your state champ picture, Krause, man. You got all those coaches, man. And I'm like, what do you mean? Every coach has a job. Steintrager's got a job. Of course, Mitch Hancock's got a job. Biondo's got a job. Carrier, Yanni. I mean, Bob Moreau, and some of the alumni come back, and they all drill with the kids. Like Matt Steintrager, he drills, and he is a huge part of CC, and no one really knows. I mean, he's not like mainstream as far as
I haven't heard of that name.
He is a killer. He's an MMA guy too. MMA guy. The whole program is phenomenal, and Mitch put it together. So it really is. Mitch and I actually did the Monterey Coaching Clinic. And I did it three times. It's like the most prestigious coaching clinic in the nation.
Yeah, I've heard it.
I'm the only guy who's done it three times, by the way. But anyway, Mitch did it.
Quick plug.
Mitch and I did it together. And I told the guy, Mitch is going to blow you out of the water. And when he got there, he did it. He did his technique. We did it with Colette and Zeke Jones, Olympic coach and coach. Anyway.
Zeke Sweet.
Yeah, Zeke Sweet. And Mitch stole the show because he had a PowerPoint presentation, how to fundraise, how to do this, how to, you know, because he fundraises all his money for the program, like 30, 40 grand would it cost to, you know, fuel that machine.
Ugh, man,
that's good stuff.
Yeah, they're like I said, they're next level. And, every Friday night here, we now have open wrestling for anyone that does listen to this. I mean, if you're tuning in to listen to Krause and you want to come in and wrestle Friday night, we got professional fighters, DCC guys, college guys, Olivet guys, MSU, U of M.
I'm coming.
You'll love it. Yeah. It's just a room of hammers it's a 90-minute session of work.
Yeah, that's fun stuff right there.
So let's talk a little bit about what you're doing now. You were telling me a little bit before the podcast, you've got some epic stuff coming up with next level wrestling.
Okay, for the last 15 years, I've been a camp guy. And let me back it up all the way back to where I became a camp guy. Can I tell you that story real quick?
Yeah, 100%.
Okay, so I was working at Cliff Keen Athletic, and I was the national sales manager. I was doing all the WOW tournaments with Jack Roller, these humongous kid tournaments, Tulsa Nationals and Reno Nationals, and they had one at West Virginia too. So anyway, Shane Roller, who's a MMA fighter, he's Jack's kid. He'd do a warm up clinic before each tournament, and I had the BRINGIT shirt that I invented, and I did a little quick.
Those are sick.
Yeah, it's pretty sick. I did a little video. And that's all I did. That's all I did, a little video. And Shane saw the video, and he couldn't make it to one of his clinics. He could call me, hey, Mark, this is Shane Roller. That's how he sounds, by the way. Hey, Mark, I can't make it to my West Virginia clinic. You think you can do it? I know you can coach. I said, sure, man, I got this. You know, so I got there, and I got there, and 58 kids showed up, and like 100 coaches. And I'm like, holy crap, you know, this is out of my comfort zone at the time. And so I called them in, and I did my shtick. And if you ever see me do a clinic, it's a little different. You know, I got them all doing stuff, you know, yelling back, you know, freeze, who's tired? Not me. I mean, all my stuff is, you know, it's high energy, it's callback stuff, and it's different. No one else does it. If they do, they copy it off me. But here's the deal. So after it was all over, there, I was like, oh my God, that was great. I can't believe you controlled all those kids like that. And I'm like, all right, well, cool. I appreciate it. That's what I do. Oh my gosh, that was fantastic. Oh, you want to do a clinic? You do a clinic with me? All these coaches are like, you do a clinic? And I'm like, what the heck's a clinic? I'm like, what do you mean, a clinic? Okay. I had no idea what to charge, what to do, anything. But I was so excited that it went over so well, and I really, truly love meeting new people, and I love coaching kids. I don't know who they are, and just seeing what we can do here. So long story short, I told my wife at the time and my parents, I'm going to be a clinic guy. And they're like, what the heck is that? My dad's like, is it pay insurance? And I'm like, no. I go, I don't know.
That's the normal dad response.
Yeah, I know. I go, this is what I'm doing, dude. So I jumped in a ring, and for the first 2 years, it wasn't pretty. You know, no one knew who this guy was, and I was dealing with the charge, and I buy my own flight at the time. I get there, and 10 kids show up, so I'm basically losing money, you know what I'm saying? And I'm like, and then Martin Floriani shows up one day at the WOW tournament, at the World of Wrestling tournament in Tulsa, and he interviews me, and then he watches me do the clinic, and he's like, wow, that was really impressive. And I'm like, thanks, man. And so he did a big interview, and he showed a couple of techniques, and then he put me, you know, and you know what's funny is Martin doesn't remember doing this. He put me on Flo as the youth coach of the century. He needed something to fill his sight. So he's plugging me, with, you know, for free or whatever, just plugging me. And when I saw that, I thought, this is the kiss of death. But, you know, I was like, well, he's pretty good. He's the man. So, you know, I was like, wow, cool, you know. And that just blew me up. And then people knew who I was. And then more and more on Flo. And pretty much I just do my own videos now and blow them up. And I've been to every state like at least, I don't know, 10 times.
How many clinics do you think you've done?
You know, it's funny you say that because I've tried to figure it out. I mean, obviously it's like I do it full year, all year round. I take April and May off and September off. I don't know, man. I think I've done more than 10,000 practices.
My God.
And that's what they say, you become an outlier after 10,000. I mean, sincerely, I mean, I'm not, you know, tooting my own horn, but you can plop me down in front of anybody. I don't care what team it is, Olympic, this, that, whatever caliber they are. I know how to run it, how to do it. And it's fun. It's fun. It's fun, and it's rewarding to know that I'm an expert at it. I really love it, man.
100%. And then that creates an extreme confidence. You know, anywhere you go in the world, you could probably go to a country where they don't even speak the same language. You know wrestling. They speak wrestling.
The guy from Ireland's been calling me.
They speak.
Yeah, and I'm like, just get me out there, dude. He's like, oh, we love you, Krause.
Yeah, say, hey, bring me out, and I love you, brother.
Yeah, right. Hey, and seriously, here's what I'm going to say to anybody out there listening, if you're a coach. If you think you're good, then plop yourself down in front of 50 coaches, which they did to me early on in my career, and with Kerry Colette in the same room, and they say, show us something we don't know. Make us laugh. you know, show me something. I was like this. I was freaked out. Frank Papalizio goes, hey, by the way, in about an hour, you're doing a coaching clinic. I'm like, what? I was just doing a clinic with kids. I'm like, what? Yeah, you and Colette are in the little room. And I went in there and Colette, you know, he's no nonsense. He's just like, you know, just gives you the
straight. Yeah, he doesn't no joke. Business.
He's no jokey guy. And one thing I learned when I was a kid, I liked when the clinicians joked to you. They're like, "What's up, Gray? What's up, Krause? You got you what? You know, people like that kind of stuff." So I went first, and they gave me like 30 kids. I ran a practice, and I was staring at 50 coaches from New York and New Jersey. They look like they're all in the mafia, and I'm thinking, "Oh my God, this is crazy." And freaking, I was going chest and knee, isn't that right, Colette? Chest and knee. That's his lingo, you know. He goes, that's right. And I'm like, what the heck, man? Be a little more fun. Anyway, but when it came time for him to do it, Colette goes, that's probably the best youth practice I've seen in my life. And he goes, elbow deep on three. And I was like, oh, now you're doing my stuff. What's up, Colette? So it was kind of cool, you know. And Frankie Egger was also there.
Wow.
But anyway, that's how you know you. That's my point is the pressure. Pressure, and I've done stuff in front of Colette, Gable, Burroughs, I mean, Askren, you name it. I mean, they play in front of everybody. Go, Krause.
Back against the wall, make it happen.
Yeah, Helen Maroulis, you name it, Kendall, Maple. I've done college. I've done huge college things. I've done 500 kid camps at ISI in front of everybody, mic'd up. So it's definitely like, you're on, buddy.
So you're already, I mean, the credentials that you just listed are astronomical. Yeah. Astronomical. Mm-hmm. But now you told me that you have a new thing that you're kind of venturing into that's right. Kind of, I don't know if you want to reveal it on the podcast or if you want to kind of keep it quiet.
I'll reveal it. Yeah. Here's what I'm doing. All right. I've traveled the nation probably, the whole nation in season probably four times, but I've been, you know, doing this for 15 years. So I've been to every state except for Alaska and Hawaii. And I think Arizona.
You got to go to Hawaii. Unbelievable.
I excited out here out there all the time. Yeah. And the wrestling is great too there. I mean, come on, man. There's a guy named Luis out there. Luis, hook me up. I'm just go there and say I'm here. Who wants a clinic?
Okay. You'll get it.
I know. I hope. That'd be fun. But, okay, so I travel the nation. I've got contacts everywhere. And that's the thing, too. I really love making relationships. I've had clinics that went sideways and people somehow, you know, oh, you don't have the money. You know what? It is what it is. You know, I'm not going to bust your balls, you know. I just want to, hey, how you doing? Your kids are great. You know, here's what my details are. And typically 95% of the time they make it. If they don't, I'm not an idiot about it. I'll see you later. Let's go. So anyway, I've got the contacts. I got everything figured out. And I'm going to do a next level army. And here's the deal. If you join the army, it's $135 a year. It's $750 a month with $30 dings on February and July that are going to actually pay my contributors. And I'm going to tell you who I have on the bubble. And it's not 100%, but it's 99.9%. Jeff Buxton, the best coach there is pretty much at any level. One of them, Colin Palmer from Ohio, Mike Kolzicki from Ohio. I've got Ray Woods, who's Real Woods' dad. He's a ball buster from New Mexico. Ray is he's a man's man. I've known Ray since Real was like a little fourth grader, and I've got Mike Mindset Moore on board, and these guys are going to contribute to the website. You're going to get my full practices. You get 12 of my full practices that are already done. I'm going to video a lot of my clinics. Mike Moore is going to be on there all the time. He loves making videos. Buxton, I'm going to have him, if you will, do at least a 20-minute practice session. Because if you're a coach or a dad or a kid, I don't want to see me going, hi, I'm Mike Krause, and this is a double leg takedown. I want to see you coach your team. That's where you get the goods, when you see someone actually interact with their team. When I see, I want to watch Gable coach. I've never seen Gable coach. I've seen him stare at the camera and go, this is a double leg. I don't care about that. I want to see you interact with your players. I want to see Tom Brands do that too. I want to see Colin Palmer. What is your break? Ready? On two. One, two, one, two. How do you break? How do you say bring it in? That's how you get better as a coach, when you actually see somebody coach. So I'm going to bring that to you. So if you're a youth wrestler or a youth parent or a youth coach, this is going to be a valuable website. You're going to get a huge discount for Adidas, 35%. And here's the real dinger. Once I set up my next level training sites, and I've got about, I'm probably going to have about 50 or 60 sites. All that means is you're willing to host a practice at a certain time when I put you on the schedule. And if you're part of the Army, say for instance, here's the deal. When I do my normal 1-2 hour practice deal, it's $30 a kid. If you're part of the Army, I'm gonna make it probably $10 a kid. Or if I'm doing it, it'll be free. I don't give a rip. If I'm making enough money off the website to survive, I'm just gonna do it free. If you're part of the Army, it's free.
Stellar.
And if you're not part of the Army, it's $30. guess what? I'll be back. And the real deal is, I'm gonna map it out where I've got. And I've got Lauren Levive and Mike Moore on board for traveling, and Kyle Waldo. And I'm gonna send them on quote unquote tours. It's the Army, so I'm gonna do all the Army talk. So they're gonna be on tours.
You're the general,
right? Yeah, totally. Yeah, exactly. If you're a host, you're a sergeant. So I got the East Coast, the Midwest, and the West Coast, and it's gonna be like about a month for each one, I think. All right, I got this is where the planning comes out. And so in November, East Coast, December, Midwest, and November, December, January. Oh, this month, okay, this year I'm doing this. I'm doing January, February, March, and then I'm skipping April, May, and then June, July, August. So every 3 months, you get another clinic for low cost.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
So you're bought into the Army, and when the troops are in town, you're training, you're putting the work in, and you're getting a massive discount, and you're getting constant content through the website.
Yes.
So you can always stay working.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
Discount from a deal. And when those guys, when I have like Mike Moore and Lauren Levive and Kyle Waller doing the tours, I'm gonna just plop down and do 3 day clinics for $20 if you're part of the Army. If you're not part of the Army, they're $175.
Exactly.
What do you want here?
There's your entire year price right there.
Yeah, exactly.
What you would pay to come to my clinic, you would have already had it covered.
It's going
to
be, hey, I'm part of the Army. Some people will join just for the content. But if you want to go to the clinic, and there will be a clinic in your state somewhere.
I'm going to give you an idea, and you can steal this. The SFS Elite team in here, they have cards that they literally keep in their wallet that says they're a part of SFS Elite, and it gets them different benefits here in the academy.
Right.
Give them their card. Give them their Army card. So when they come into town, they give you the card. It's laminated.
All right, here's the deal. Okay, well, back when I was a little kid, I used to be part of the Dread card. It was a credit card, it was a fake credit card. It was Detroit Rockers against everything disco, and I was probably like 10. All right, it's back in like 79. And I remember I had like a fake credit card. I felt so cool because I had this credit card.
100%.
So I've looked in the credit card machines. This next level Army. So little kids carrying around a little card, you know, so he feels cool. I mean, that's the whole thing. Make it feel cool.
It's brilliant. Honestly, like I said, that's why we have invitation cards here.
Yeah.
Anyone that's an SFS Elite can pull out their card that says SFS Elite number. It's got their name on it. Right. It's got everything laid out.
Yeah.
It's got the logo.
Your serial number.
And it just makes you feel awesome.
I'm saying, man, it's all about feeling cool.
You're a part of something different. You know what I mean? So
totally.
And man, I'd love to. Like I said, anytime you're in town, I want you. Anything you want to run here, you're gonna have all this space to use, and we need to blow this thing up.
Yeah.
At some point, I mean, Mike Moore already does a little bit of wrestle jitsu, but I mean, we could do something together where we bounce around. I know every MMA gym out there. You know the wrestling spots. Right. We throw wrestle jitsu camps on.
I love doing wrestling camps for jiu-jitsu guys. They're so appreciative. I mean, I did one with David Taylor. We went to Matt Hamill's gym. I just showed single legs, double legs, and they're like, "Thank you so much." And I was like, "Really? Okay." I mean, they were so cool, you know.
A lot of jiu-jitsu people still can't wrestle. We need to fix that.
That wrestling stuff.
It's not good.
Pretty damn tough too.
No, it flows together perfect. And Mike Moore is a great guy to compliment you, because we were actually the first school to ever implement his mindset training program. You know that?
Oh, really?
In the country.
I knew he was here. And Mike Moore's tough.
We were the first one that took him on board as a mental coach and had him with our team.
Us three together, I don't know who would talk more.
It'd be awesome.
More Mike.
Can you imagine the energy in that room?
Yeah, totally. Yeah, I've been to his place a couple times, or one time, but we did that Kansas camp together, and it was fantastic. Me, him, and Lauren Levive. It was really phenomenal.
Money. You bring people together like that, it's just going to be stellar. So, man, just anything else you want to record on this podcast? We've crushed a half an hour. Good talk.
That's it?
You know. Yeah, I mean, like it was nothing.
Well, let's talk about your place here, man. This is fantastic. I mean, when did you get in here? Because I remember I was here like 2 years ago, and you've been here for like, what, 10 years?
So I've been in the community, 10 years now coaching, and we've been in this building for 3 years. I'm not going to talk about what's...
Top secret.
We got, you know, just under 14,000 square feet here in the community. Right. We just got Josh Parisian in the UFC as a male. We're the only gym that's put a female in the UFC, Robbie Cooper.
We just had
Alicia Zapatella win a world title for Invicta. She won a world title over in China. I mean, we really... This year has brought more success than you know. 2020 has been the best year ever for us once all this bullshit was out of the way. Colin Anglin just got signed to the UFC, and not only did he get signed, he probably had the best fight of the season on Contender. It was unbelievable.
Who was Colin's youth wrestling coach? I can't remember.
South Lion.
Get back, Coach Krause.
Who is it? Coach Krause. Yeah, I know.
Hey, I just, you know, the best thing when I walked in here, there was all those, I think it was a women's class, was it?
Punches and Crunches. Okay. It was the women and the kids jiu-jitsu was on the mat.
And here's the deal. They were just average women. All right, just normal people. They weren't like fighters, but they were killing it. And that's, I mean, I don't, if you think this is intimidating coming here, it's not. That's why I think that people might think is intimidating, because it's not. You walk in here and people are just kicking the bags and getting nutso. And
dude, we're a place for everybody.
Coaching, yeah.
We've got 4-year-olds that train here all the way up to people in their 60s.
I posted that video of you already on
Facebook.
Awesome.
I'm going to go and watch it.
And when I got in that jiu-jitsu class, I knew it was apparently the beginner class. Those guys weren't beginners. But I said this one lady next to me. I said, is this the beginner class? She goes, yeah. I was like, I don't think it looks like it. Oh, she goes, there's some pros in here. I'm like, no kidding. Look at that guy right there. But it was her third practice. So, I mean, people, it's for everybody. It's for everybody.
Yeah. I mean, your group was professional fighter, jiu-jitsu purple belt, and a professional. You had two professional fighters in your group, and you had Ramsdale, who's a purple belt and a monster too.
Yeah, trust me, I know.
So your group was savage, but yeah, that's our fundamental class. But so many people value fundamentals. Like, think about a single and a doubles, fundamental in wrestling. But Jordan Burroughs makes career off.
Right, and those guys were being cool to me. They were like, they were letting me do stuff, and they were just like working on their. They were actually working on their. Techniques on with my bad technique. Yeah. I get it. It was like putting the A guy versus the B guy and letting the A guy just, you know, work his stuff.
Yeah. And you know what? That's something really cool I think about mixed martial arts. Is think about if you're in a baseball player, you don't get to go play with people in the MLB. If you're in a football player, you don't go play with the Lions.
Yeah,
In it's MMA, true. You can walk on the mat and you can train with Josh Parisian. You can train with Alicia Zavatelli. Yeah. You were just training with two pros tonight. You know what I mean? Yeah. So it's sick that like in this sport, you can just stroll out there and be with some of the best in the world, shake hands and get, you know, get good work every night.
Yeah. You know, cool about MMA is that when you go to an MMA fight, there's no one's being a dick.
Yeah,
everyone's cool. Everyone's a good guy. Yeah,
I think it's because we all know we're gonna fight.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. When you fight me,
you don't have to. Yeah, exactly. Like, what's up? How can things escalate? We're gonna fight.
I remember when I was at Cliff Keen, we got an MMA and they took me to a fight, and I was walking to the guys going, "What's up?" And I was like, fake punching him, and the guy's like, "Oh, you don't do that." Not the guy, but the guy I was with. And I was like, "Dude, we're good here. We're good." He was like, "Oh man, you really know how to handle these. I'm a combat guy. I'm not gonna. They know I'm being funny." So we're all, you know, everyone's a good dude. Everyone's a good guy.
Yeah, it's been remarkable to see how, I mean, remember when MMA was first hitting the scene back when I was teaching in high school? MMA was like the side freak show thing that some,
it was too dangerous.
100%. Oh, blah, blah, blah. We can't put it on TV. We can't have blood on TV.
Blood, right.
And now, I mean, this sport is taking over the world. It's blowing up. Mm-hmm. You know, even when all the other sports were shut down, Dana White's up there going, not my sport.
Yeah, right,
we're fighters.
Yeah,
right. We're putting our people back out there.
Yeah, totally.
Let's talk a little bit about 2020. What has it been like for you? Has it caused chaos for you, or have things been kind of normal?
Well, when it hit this thing hit in April, those were my off months, April and May. But I had some tournaments lined up. I was going to be the warm up guy, whatnot. They of course got canceled, but it wasn't a big deal. I just crushed a whole winter. But then June hit, and some of my college camps obviously got canceled, but I take deposits for my camps, so the ones that couldn't happen got pushed to August. They're still pushed a little bit, but I immediately filled up June with Oklahoma, Texas, states that just don't give a rip, you know, and I went to New Mexico with Ray Woods, and so I just filled them up. As you know, I just handled it. I adapted.
Made the best of it. You said, you know what, I'm not going to stress about it.
No.
And at the end of the day, I mean, I just feel like certain people, fear cripples them a lot more, and fear gets in people's head.
Oh,
and
gosh.
Listen, when you're a wrestler, you're a jiu-jitsu practitioner, you're a fighter, like you just, listen, we try to strangle each other for fun.
Right,
you breathe all over me, sweat all over each other. Yeah. We don't think about things like that.
I think I'm immune.
Yeah, exactly.
Seriously.
If we're not at this point, you've had people sweat in your mouth and your eyes.
Oh, my gosh.
It's life.
Right.
And you don't even think about it. And you know what you do? You shake the partner's hand, you go to a different one.
Yeah, you know? I don't want to go into it, but you know as well as I do. I mean, the whole, in fact, I don't want to go into it.
No, but, I don't want to take it down that road either.
Yeah,
but I mean, somehow I ended up on the national Fox News.
Right. Yeah, you did a great job. You really crushed it. I was like, go, James, go.
Yeah, it was wild, man. I never want to go down that road again. I never thought I'd be sitting challenging.
You were like the spokesperson for the what's up.
Tell you, I was. I mean,
I loved it.
I got to have lunch with Shelly from Texas and Carl the Barber. The three of us had lunch together.
I saw that. Yeah,
it was pretty wild. So it was, you know, never in my life would I have thought I'd be challenging a governor's executive order. Like, that's the most powerful person in that's the president of the state.
Yeah.
And, you know, here I am being like, I'm not going to follow this bullshit. And, you know, luckily it's worked out for us. And, like, you know what? You know what I'm afraid of? In a couple of weeks, people are going to start getting sick. They get sick every year. It's flu season.
Oh, yeah.
Is the media going to take that and spin us back into madness?
For sure.
Or are people not going to take it this time and say, listen, no.
Yeah.
We'll live our lives.
Yeah, don't go in.
Like I said, I don't want to go further into it. Mm-mm. But let's just say 2020 is going to be one of the best years in our history. So
right.
It's turned out really, really well.
I love it.
So just like I said, Krause, man, it's always a pleasure having you in the building.
Love it.
It's truly a pleasure. Anytime you ever want to set something up here, you want to jump in on the wrestling practice, you want to run camps here, you got ideas for things that we can do together. You okay. Let me know. Let's make it happen.
Well, I'll talk to you after the podcast. I go on the road. Every weekend's booked. Third week of October on, but first two weekends of October is too quick. This one, but maybe the second week we just do something.
Heck yeah!
All right, let's do it.
While you're in town, quick drop. Hey, like a pop-up shop, all those things, right? That for clothing gear. Hey, it's a pop-up shop on this day at this time. We're going to have this gear on this day at this time. You got Krause in the building and we're running it.
I'm in, man.
Before you get on the road.
I love it.
So, man, thank you for joining me today on the podcast. Truly a pleasure, Krause. And, just anytime you want to be in here, you're welcome, brother.
Can I get a get back on three? One, two, three. Get back.